It's always a good idea to begin with a pochade. That's a thumbnail sketch. And it's quite small. It's only about, this is 8 by 6 1/4 inches wide. It's quite small. But this is your dress rehearsal. This is where you work out the color, your composition, and also it's a good vehicle for practicing your brush strokes, especially now that we're getting into bravura. Bravura is where you see, you assess, and you strike. Take no prisoners. So, let's begin. I always streak my pochades, the same as I would do any painting. Here I just used a mixture of yellow ochre, raw umber, a little ivory black, and a medium of 2 parts turp to 1 part walnut oil, and mixing it up to very dilute, I just streaked the canvas. And here I streaked it from top to bottom. Now, I've set up my palette, which is my basic academic palette. I use flake white, titanium nickel yellow, yellow ochre light or pale for this painting, vermilion, Venetian red, burnt sienna, raw umber, ultramarine blue. Now, I don't know how Frans afforded ultramarine blue in this painting, but he did, and vine black. You can also use ivory black. And here I'm going to use 2 part stand oil to 1 part turpentine, and I also add a few drops of Venetian turpentine. That's not really a turpentine, it's an oleo resin. It gives the paint a jewel-like quality. Now, I'm going to mix up raw umber, ivory black, or vine black, equal proportions, and I'm going to dilute that to the consistency of Chinese ink. Now, before I begin on my pochade, I'm checking for what is called the rabotment. The rabotment is applying a square on within your canvas. This is a very powerful compositional tool. And making some decisions here. And I think I'm going to place my sternal notch at the rabotment. And then from there, I just assess the base of the chin, the mentalis, top of the head, and now I'm going to strike in the facial angle. This determines the tilt of the head. Now with a loaded brush and using straight architectonic lines, I'm going to ascribe the large overall shape of the head. Usually I begin at the top of the head, then I scoot on down to the mentalis. That just helps me get things placed in. And I'm just using my eyeball. I'm just eyeing it. But I'm also using a long-handled brush. This long-handled brush gives me a greater distance from the canvas, which allows me to better assess shape and the angles. It also gives for a more fluid line. You know, I don't want to get picky. I want to be loose. I want to be accurate. But I don't want to be picky, I don't want to be rigid. I mean, this is a loose woman. Paint loose. Okay? And then, just going to quickly block in my overall light-dark pattern. You know, I scrub it in, I cross-hatch. I skip around. I just want to work from very general, and then I will gradually go specific. Everything here is about the expression. Now the expression of Gypsy Girl is, it looks like she just swallowed a bird, or it looks like she's just laughing at a joke. It's a very fast expression. These are these trojis that, you know, these character studies that Frans Hals was perhaps the greatest at doing. How he captured these expressions is just sheer genius. So I'm just going to quickly indicate my brow line, the base of the nose, the interstices of the mouth, and I don't want any details. The most I'm going to do with the eyes is I'm just going to establish the eye sockets. This is a rehearsal. It's not a tiny little painting. We save that for later. All I want to get in this pochade is the overall composition, the color scheme, and also I want to analyze and gain a deeper understanding of the planes of the head. Now, it's going to be a little trickier in this painting because the planes are articulated very subtly. And so we are going to have to step back and figure this one out. And I'm just making decisions, scrubbing in tone, working out the angles, the rough shapes. And again, just in case it needs reminding, don't go stiff on me. Keep it loose. As loose as a goose. And following through on my initial decision, I'm going to place that sternal notch, that lovely little piece of light at the base of her neck, right on the rebotment. And this is going to lock her into place. And this is as far as I want to go with my initial sketch. I don't need any more. Keep it simple. Keep it elegant. Now, we're going to mix up three basic flesh tones. We're going to mix our dark light, our middle light, and our light. So I'm going to grab some of my raw umber ivory black gravy, and I'm going to add some yellow ochre to that, a little touch of nickel yellow, some Venetian red, some burnt sienna, because the warms are found mostly in the dark lights, to a lesser extent into the middle lights, and barely at all into the lights. So far, so good. Now, while I'm here, I'm also going to mix up a, dark light. This will serve as a transition between light to darks. Now, mixing up my middle light value, take a little bit of yellow ochre, a bit more of nickel yellow. I add some white, but not too much white. We don't want to chalk out. And I'm going to warm this up with a touch of vermilion. And again, I want to mix a nice cohesive batch and make sure you mix up enough paint for your pochade. Otherwise, you'll need to remix your hue. Hue is a specific color. Now, to get into my light, I'm going to start with nickel yellow, a little touch of yellow ochre, more white, but be careful, white is not your friend, but it is necessary. And then, to cut down the yellow a bit, I'm going to add a little bit of black, just a tiny, tiny bit. All I want to do with this primary compound complement, which black is to yellow, I just want to cut it down a bit. I want to cut that yellow so my light doesn't look jaundiced. And there I have it now. I have my dark light, my middle light, and my light. And beginning with, the ébauche for our pochade, which will be quite quick, you want to go just a little bit darker. Now I'm just going to grab a filbert, a number 10 filbert, but they're all different sizes depending upon the manufacturer. Dip it in my medium, I pull it out, and I give my brush a nice little massage so that the bristles are moist, well oiled, and that will hold the filbert shape. Now I'm going to window shade, starting at the hairline with my dark light. I'm just going to ascribe the shape of the forehead where it meets the hairline. hairlines are always transparent. Now, switching to my middle light, I want to start working out the planes of the forehead. The forehead is not flat. It's actually quite convex. It's more squarish at the temples. And as we come towards the front of the forehead, there's also a small, very shallow concavity. It's not a bad idea to clasp your hand to your forehead, and you'll feel it's almost like holding a ball. And to get extra mileage, I direct my brush strokes to follow the forms of the forehead. This is painting with a sculptural sensibility. It's as if I'm working in clay. And with my light value, I'm going to indicate my frontal orbital eminence, where the light hits it. I want to go a little bit finer in my color mixes. So now I need to break it down a little bit further. And I'll just add a little bit of vermilion red just to warm it up, just to get the sense of the blood flowing through here. I mean, she's a Northern European 16th century woman. So she has a very pale and a very ruddy complexion. The diet was quite fatty. I think it's a pretty good guess to say she didn't get outside much, and she spent more of her time at the buffet table. Progressing downwards, window shading. I'm going to work around the eye sockets. I don't want to go into them right now. Instead, I'm going to start going into the cheeks and articulating the forms of the upper zygomatic arch. This is the upper cheekbone. Now, of course, in the previous workshop, Rembrandt Laughing, is where we focused on the anatomy. In Frans Hals, Gypsy Girl, we're going to use both the anatomy and color, but the emphasis is on color and also on plane. So with my half and half of dark light and middle light that's been warmed up with a little touch of vermilion, I'm going to establish the plane changes of those cheeks. Now, as you can see with my palette here, I'm modulating my colors. I'm adding a little bit of vermilion. Sometimes I'll add some Venetian red. Sometimes it needs to be knocked down with a little bit of raw umber. Raw umber is technically a green. Green and reds are complementaries. So if you go a little bit too hot with your vermilion, you can tone it or knock it down with a touch of raw umber. Don't think of color mixing as recipes. I give you guidelines. But how you really learn how to mix flesh color is through a sense of play within the guidelines, within the palette that I've given you. And it's through structured play that you learn the most. With succinct brushstrokes, I want to develop voluminous cheeks. Cheeks are quite full, especially being pushed up by the nasal labial fold, the smile lines. And so I'm working mostly with my warmed up middle light and my light. I'm balancing warm against cool, middle light against light, all the while articulating the underlying form. And again, paint with a sculptural sensibility. Direct those brushstrokes to follow the actual physical forms of the cheeks. You get oh so much more mileage doing so. And that is called an economy of means. That is the essence of bravura painting. You assess and you strike. And with a warmed up value of just adding Venetian red and vermilion to half and half of my light and my dark light, I'll go in and ascribe the general shape of the eye sockets. Like the eyes, I'm going to work my way around the nose. So I'm going to go to the upper muzzle first. This is the area between the base of the nose and the upper lip. This too is quite convex. It turns. That's kind of like a piece of a baseball. You can clasp your hand to your muzzle and you can feel that convex form. Now it's time to approach the nose. I find it best painting the nose to work your way upwards. Start with the greater alar. That's the big two pieces of cartilage that form the tip of your nose. And it's going to be quite warm. She is, after all, a bar girl. Plenty of ale. And I'm going to work my way up the cartilage of the nose. Now, the nose is three-dimensional, and we want to break it down into its specific forms. Or to rephrase, I want to articulate its planar construction. Basically, I don't want a flat nose that looks like it's been punched in. It has to come forward from the cheek area and now into the jaw. And it's in this jaw that we have to observe carefully and succinctly the various muscle actions, the zygomatic major, the zygomatic minor, the masseter, all these forms that are pushing up the cheeks and the nodes of the mouth into this guffaw, as it were, into this very fleeting expression, which again, we're breaking down into its planar forms. So the pochade within the face is all about the planes and the basic color values. We've made some modulations, but they're fairly elementary. We just want to get a sense of the expression. And with a much warmed up piece of my middle light, I'm going to just quickly indicate my lips. If you don't get them at the first shot, take your knife, scrape it down, do it again. Okay, you don't want to pick at it. Try to hit it with just a few brush strokes. Doing so, you will well familiarize yourself with this expression of the mouth and the cheeks and the entire muzzle. That way you won't be approaching the full painting in a state of absolute mystery. In painting, familiarity breeds confidence. And finally, for the head, I'm going to go into the neck, remembering that my sternal notch is placed at the ribotment. And I'm just going to check that. It never hurts to constantly check your drawing as the painting progresses. Things can slip away without your noticing it. Eyes become smaller. Noses shrink. Mouths shrink. The eyebrow raises. All kinds of stuff happens. So, take a few moments now and then and recheck your drawing. And finally, I'm just going over again the shape of my face. It's in shape that the likeness is found. It's not so much in the details. It is. But most important is the overall shape. And with my brush handle, I'm going to rearticulate the overall shape of the head just to get the hair. I know it's too wide. That's okay. Nothing is written in stone. Anything and everything can still be moved around. However, break your hair down with straight architectonic lines. Straight lines will give a greater sense of structure. Don't make arcing lines through the hair, especially not at this point. Now, with a mixture of mostly raw umber and a touch of vine black, I'm going to go back in and darken the hair, and while I darken it, I'm also going to further redefine the shape of the head and the shape of the face. Color theory-wise, raw umber is extremely close to being the primary compound complement of blue. And this is going to play a big part in uniting the figure-ground relationship. Especially when I start putting in the blue in the upper right corner of the canvas. Now, as I lay in the hair, I'm actually falling into, well, hairdresser mode. I'm going to apply the hair as if I'm actually brushing her hair. The one thing you don't want to do is just lay it in super flat. Just crosshatch it, brush it in, and follow the forms of the hair. And that goes a long, long way towards giving a greater sense of hair. And as I further refine the shape of the face, I'm also going to knit the edges together. I want it to be slightly, well, blended. I don't want a hard edge. I don't want the hair to look like it's been cut out of a magazine and pasted on. There's always a transparency between the actual flesh and the hair. And I'm going to continue this shape into the underlying part of the jaw and the cast shadow upon the neck. With a mixture of vermilion and Venetian red, now's a good time to sketch in and knock in the red dress. But note too, but my brush strokes skip over the surface. I don't want to make it too heavy. It's a rough, dry brushwork. Let the imprimatura shimmer forth. Let it play. And since I'm down in that area with my light flesh value, let's just quickly knock in the upper chest. Again, not flat. I'm cross-hatching it in, letting the imprimatura shimmer forth, following the forms of the chest. And into the blouse with a slightly knocked-down white where I've used violet. This is a mixture of ultramarine blue, burnt sienna, and a little touch of raw umber just to knock it down a bit. Now it's time to mix the blue for the background. So, taking just a bit of ultramarine blue and some white, just want to mix up a nice cohesive batch. And I'm going to add just a little bit more white. Now I'm just going to place a little piece of raw umber next to my blue. Look at that beautiful interaction. Primary compound complements shimmer forth like little jewels. And to knock down my blue, I'm going to add some of that raw umber into it. And, oh, what the heck, let's add some middle flesh value to it, too. That will help harmonize the background with the figure. And now to start laying in the ground, or the background. Technically, it's better to call it the ground, because our main focus here is working out this figure-ground relationship. Remember, unity is the overriding concern. It overrides everything. Now, to pump up the blue a little bit, just like Frans Hals did, I'm adding a little bit of my middle flesh value, which is quite close to a muted orange. Orange and blue are complementaries, side by side. They pump up each other's vibrancy. And I'm just following Hall's diagonal strokes but not always. I want to build up my abstract structural surface a little bit. I want to play with it, see how it goes. I don't want to put this in too timidly. Remember, the pochade is our rehearsal. This is where we can try things out. And because I'm never satisfied, I'm going to go back into the hair and I'm going to darken it even further. In other words, what I want here is to get the full stretch from light to dark. I don't want to have a timid painting. I want to get that blast, light to dark, bang, bang. Hence, the hair is the excellent vehicle for pushing down those darks. Having the blue in there now, we can see how that pumps up the flesh tones. It gives it much more of a glow. Color is interactive. It depends upon all of the other colors in the neighborhood to achieve unity and to bring it to life. Now it's time to mix up the primary compound complement to the red. Now I'm going to start off with some raw umber, my mix. Now I want to mix an olive green. So I'm going to take vine black, which is technically a blue, and nickel yellow, and that gives me a fairly close approximation to olive green. And now I'm going to mix that into my raw umber. And this is going to come pretty close to giving me that primary compound complement to red. Be sure to take full advantage of the color theory workshop that I've included with Frans Hals' Gypsy Girl. As with Rembrandt, the anatomy is extremely important. Now I want to deepen your understanding with color theory. Everything goes hand in hand. As I lay in the ground with this primary compound complement of red, you can see how the reds are starting to glow. The reds not only of the dress, but also the vermilions of the cheeks and in the flesh. And with my palette knife, I'm going to play around with building up that abstract structural surface, the patina of the paint. In other words, relish, feel joy in the paint, build it up, let the paint be paint. And as I've said before, don't try to push it into something that it's not. And in these final moments of the pochade, I want to pull the lights out even further. I want to get more definition. How much further can I get this stretch from light to dark? If I go too far, as is my wont, then simply take your knife, scrape it out, and do it again. It's just a pochade. This is where you want to make all your mistakes. Save the victories, save the glories for the main event, for the main painting.